I really only know through the miracle of video. I watched one of her presentations and I was so impressed. I thought she'd be a perfect person to come and speak to our workshop. Joyce Kwan is an associate professor of architecture at the University of Buffalo at SUNY and the director of Ants of the Prairie, an office of architectural practice and research that focuses on confronting contemporary ecological conditions through creative means. And you'll certainly see, I think you're in for a wonderful talk about the creative means that she has both designed and developed for dealing with these issues. She's a recipient of the 2014 Emerging Voices Award from the Architectural League of New York, the 2013 New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship, and is a McDowell Fellow. And her architectural practice, projects, and writing have been featured in a host of international and national publications, and if I was to list them, we'd be through the talk. So I think you can look at them in your, we have a bio in your swag bags. Detailing the publications. She's a co-editor of the book Beyond Patronage, Reconsidering Models of Practice, and the co-organizer of the Hive City Bee Habitat competition. So I'm sure there's a lot of synergies between some of the presenters and the audience with the ongoing work that Joyce is doing. She's a registered architect in New York State and has practiced professionally with offices in New York, Philadelphia, San Francisco, and Barcelona. And she received a post-professional Master of Architecture degree from Princeton and a Bachelor of Architecture degree from Cornell University. So I really enthusiastically welcome her.
Well, thank you, Sue, for the invitation, and thanks to everyone for bringing me here. This is a really, really exciting event, and the topic of this conference is so interesting to me, and I was just telling Virginia, I think this is the first time I've been at a conference that's explicitly about habitecture. So did you guys invent the word even? No, it's so I'm very excited about this. So anyway, thanks again for having me. It's a real pleasure to be here. Just the other day, I was really excited about coming here because I heard about that raccoon that climbed into the subway. So I was thinking, yes, I'm going to go to Toronto. But anyway, so my practice is called Ants of the Prairie, and just to introduce you a bit to my studio, as Sue mentioned, we're based in Buffalo, and in our work, especially the most recent work, we've been developing visible spatial ways to confront ecological challenges, and our position is that we see these challenges not as limitations, but as instigators for creative practice and bringing awareness to particular issues of interest. And as you mentioned, I'm also a faculty member at the University of Buffalo School of Architecture and Planning, so you'll see throughout the presentation that there's a kind of crossover between some of the work that I'm doing in my practice and some of the research and teaching trajectories that I've been pursuing at the school. So in the last few years, last 5 years or so, or more actually, I've become preoccupied with what I think of as conflicted perceptions of wildlife, and especially the idea of the urban pest. And I would argue that within the current discourses of architecture and sustainable design, the ecosystemic role of animals is relatively marginalized. So while animals are often seen as legal regulations in cities, they're on the fringe in architectural discussions. And so we're interested in seeing how architecture can enter this picture and move the consideration of animals beyond urban regulations, of course also including them, but thinking also very explicitly about agendas of aesthetic space, environmental performance, and even ethics. Well, where do we see animals now? We know that the condition of habitat loss is not new. We know that for quite some time, in processes of urbanization have been depleting cities of biodiversity. And we also see today many cities that are attempting to counter these effects by introducing different measures. So this, for example, is Bolsa Chica Reserve near my hometown in Orange County, California. This is formerly an oil drilling area, and now it's been reconstructed as wetlands, and now it's kind of full of many species of birds and aquatic life. This is Buffalo. Despite these ambitions to to reclaim nature. Somehow we see other attitudes beginning to emerge when nature takes over cities in unintended ways. And so if you think about urban areas like Buffalo that lack regular maintenance, such as lawn mowing, this happens a lot in post-industrial cities that are, Buffalo that are kind of, economically declining. These sites are not considered, ideal forms of nature. We see a lot of vacant and neglected properties that are often overgrown, and in that state, they're often teeming with different forms of life. This is actually a house that was purchased by my thesis students that they were going to renovate. And also in Buffalo, this is, we see a lot of this crumbling, dilapidated buildings full of nooks and crannies and small spaces. So these actually serve as ideal situations for animal life in cities. And you could argue that these kinds of neglected sites produce suitable conditions for developing habitat, but again, they're not seen as ideal examples of nature, but rather they're considered to be forms of urban blight. So this conflict of attitude can also be traced to the way we consider the presence of animals in nature in cities. On the one hand, we see artifacts like this. We see birdhouses and birds as desirable creatures. But what happens when we see a situation like this, when wildlife encroaches upon more densely populated areas? Suddenly, birds are not so desirable. And in the realm of legal regulations, many animals are classified as nuisance wildlife. So this is in New York State. The New York Department of Environmental Conservation has this list of nuisance animals. And they even include species that you're allowed to take. So these are species that you can pursue, shoot, hunt, or kill at any time. I went through and just kind of outlined the ones that you could take. And in case you're curious, these are chipmunks, mice, moles, porcupines, rats, shrews, red squirrels, but not gray or black ones, voles, woodchucks, groundhogs, and in the bird list, there's European starlings, house sparrows, and pigeons without leg bands. And of course, we see the perception of this idea of the nuisance in the artifacts that that we construct for these species. So think, for example, in the realm of birds, we always see these ubiquitous wildlife or bird prevention spikes. We always see these kind of nets on buildings to prevent birds from landing on them. And so I've been really interested in bats recently because I think even more so than birds, bats face particularly difficult circumstances. They're critical to our ecosystem, as I'm sure you all well know. They serve as pollinators and pesticides, but their role in our lives is for the most part underestimated, I think. Currently, bats are dying off in great numbers due to white nose syndrome, which I'm sure most of you are aware is a white fungus that develops on a bat's nose, and it wakes them up while they're hibernating, and they end up flying around, and they don't have enough energy to fly, and they end up dying. So it's an epidemic that's causing death of a lot of bats that started in the northeastern part of the United States in 2006. It's quickly spreading westward. This is a sort of map. This is actually from a little while back in 2010, but showing the kind of westward spread. There's the Great Lakes there, so you can see the westward spread of white nose syndrome. And so this is an epidemic, and this is a crisis, but it's something that I think is hardly on the public radar. Bats, of course, get a bad rap from popular media. Of course, consider movies like Dracula or Vampire Bats. This is storyboards by the artist Jeff Wall for a movie. And so maybe it's because of their reputation that one could argue that their presence in cities is often intentionally diminished. So of course there are examples of very large, interesting bat houses, especially those from the 1920s by Charles Campbell. And there's also examples like Congress Street Bridge and places where people enjoy seeing bats coming out. But if you look at the kind of typical off-the-shelf bat house that you can buy online or at a store or somewhere, they're usually made to kind of blend into the background. They look like existing house components. They're kind of unremarkable character, like these boxes on trees in Buffalo. And even there are building components that are made to house bats. So this is a company called Schwegler that's making bat bricks. These are essentially like hollowed out bricks that can be used in buildings. And anyway, so you can see in the bottom photo there, like that the brick has basically been incorporated into the wall of this building. So while it's, the intention is to, you know, to provide that inhabitation spaces as an artifact, it still literally blends into the background. So given these conflicting logics and attitudes, so on the one hand, this recognition of animals is somehow beneficial, and on the other hand, our repulsion toward them, I'm interested in how architects can develop strategies for incorporating diverse habitats into the built environment, and how we can begin through kind of creative processes, begin to shift public perception away from thinking about animals as, you know, pests, or the preconceptions of pests, and towards a new idea, different ideas about the benefits of biodiversity. So the first strategy in my work as a practice is to visually intensify the presence of animals or bats or other so-called pests by developing habitat conditions that give them a spatial and tactile presence. This project is called Pest Wall. It's a kind of speculative project it's basically rendering a renovation of a house where I'm asking, well, how can a wall not only act as a facade, but also as a membrane that incorporates conditions for bat habitation? Could we begin to rethink the performance of the vernacular house? Can we begin to rethink the actual image of the vernacular house? And here's another kind of speculative project, imagining, well, what if the side of a vacant building were turned into an animal habitat? Certainly the ambition of seeing a large multi-story wall teeming with bats and other animals would certainly provoke us to face some of these attitudes and fears toward urban wildlife. That was my contention. But you know, despite all these ambitions, it was actually hard to get started with this agenda, and especially in the city. So to begin actually realizing, you know, building projects to realize an architectural campaign for wildlife habitat advocacy, we began a park, which is a place where people might more readily accept the idea of animals as part of our world. So the installation that I'm showing here is the first built project from 2010 from a series of small-scale interventions that I've been working on. This is called Bat Tower, which is from 2010, looking from above and the base on the right-hand side. From our research, we found that, and I know some of you guys are working on bats here as well, so I'm sure you know a lot about this as well, but we found that there are several bat species that, in the Northeast in particular, that tend to inhabit small spaces within covered areas, and they can enter through very, very small openings that are less than half an inch wide, like some of these slotted spaces. The kind of bat houses and bat roosts that you see, so this is looking up toward a kind of standard bat house. This is from Bat Conservation International. You see a lot of these kind of thin slotted spaces that are typical to bat house construction. And so the tectonic agenda that we were thinking about for this project was to create a, you know, exterior as well, using a lot of thin slotted spaces and crevices. So this is the exterior of the project where we incorporated a lot of protruding fins and grooved surfaces. So those kind of etched surfaces are almost like ladders that a bat could climb on to climb up. And the interior we imagined kind of like a vertical cave, also filled with crevices and small spaces that that could be suitable for bat habitation. This is looking down from the top. Another condition that we were interested in was the thermal environment. We wanted to create a warm thermal environment that's conducive to roosting. In typical bat habitats, there's a lot of heat that's produced by the bats huddling together. But in this case, we wanted it to absorb sunlight. So what you're looking at is when you look up to the top, the red blob there is basically showing how the exterior, so that's looking up toward the exterior part, how that's absorbing, because the outside skin is a piece of dark wood. It's absorbing more sunlight than the rest of it. So you can see how much warmer it is on the top part of this tower. We also designed a very wide and heavy base to stabilize the structure, but also the base became a sort of planter. So within the base, we planted a lot of herbs that was meant to attract insects that then would hopefully attract bats to the tower. Now, due to the unique form of the structure, there ended up being over 400 pieces of wood. And in order to, you know, just organize all this, we needed to develop a labeling system. So we thought thought, well, let's develop a Braille labeling system, and this is what you're seeing here. So each one of these pieces of wood is labeled with a Braille number, which is kind of interesting. Everyone who works on the project sort of learned Braille and sort of felt their way around the wood pieces. And you can see the effect of these kind of openings, this Braille language on the exterior of the bat tower. So we built the project in modules because this was first developed as a prototype and we didn't really initially have a site to work with. So we conceived of it as a series of modules that could be transported and stacked with relative ease since we didn't really know where this was going. And as I mentioned, I was actually trying to get this built somewhere in the city and there were a few false starts, but finally the organization that was willing to work with us was the Griffith Sculpture Park, which is in a town outside of Buffalo and managed by the Ashford Hollow Foundation. This was the kind of path going up to the site. It ended up posing a big challenge. We had to move all these components up this muddy, unpaved hill. So fortunately, due to the fact that we had built it in modules, it took the team only a couple of days, really, to assemble the project on site. Here's just some photos from the installation assembly weekend. So the overall form and scale of the installation stands in contrast to the typical tactics of bat house camouflage. I like to think of the kind of off-the-shelf bat houses as kind of homes being camouflaged. So rather than blending into the background, this project asserts itself as a sizable presence in the landscape. So from afar, it looks like a pristine sculpture, but as you get closer up, you start to see the messy evidence of life. And you see bats emerging at dusk, you see spider webs, see other insects taking over. It actually looks even more scratched up even now. I have an even more recent photo where there's like claw marks on one part of the pin. You see droppings, plant growth all over. So it's interesting how it has a very different presence, both from afar and up close. So this next project is called Habitat Wall. Now, after we built the Bat Tower project, we initiated several other projects in attempts to tackle similar issues and interests. And this is, as I mentioned, Habitat Wall. It's a large wall that was initially designed to be on the side of an existing shed building in the Audubon Society Center in Buffalo. What you're looking at here is a model that I built while I was at the McDowell Colony, where I was working on this first working on the project. As you can see, it's composed of a series of bays. So these are all bays kind of between different structural frames. This is a kind of closer up study of one of the bays, kind of looking at how these pieces might assemble. So again, the spatial ideas for the bed and habitation of these kind of sliver, kind of slotted spaces in the bottom, and you can start to see the kind of addition of the birdhouse structures at the top of the piece. So these are just some kind of more closer studies. Here's a few photos of the project under construction in our shop. When we started stacking the pieces together, you can again see that language of the slotted space is really sort of being very prominent. So these are some of these pieces we were stacking. We were actually stacking the pieces trying to figure out how to get them into a truck. So we actually mocked up the size of the truck with blue tape and then tried to fit all these pieces in. It was pretty crazy, actually. But anyway, So I like this photo because it really kind of reveals some of the sort of spatial qualities that result from thinking about the idea of slotted, thin, layered spaces. Another strategy that we're working with this was to use recycled materials and to use reclaimed building materials. So you can see, for example, all these shutters that were used in the project, there's a lot of salvaged wood as well. And unlike the bat house, unlike the bat tower project, in this case, we wanted to use only straight cuts. So rather than there's no CNC milling, I don't know how many architects are here actually. I'm really curious if anybody even knows what I'm talking about. So with the bat tower, we use the CNC milling, which is a kind of computerized production machine. In this case, because in the last project, the CNC milling actually ended up costing like half the budget or something. It would cost more than the materials. So in this case, we said, okay, we're not going to use this. We're just going to use straight cuts. So this is all completely fabricated by hand using straight tools in the shop. So there's, so we're also thinking about the means of production. Now, recently we were commissioned by the School of the Arts Institute of Chicago to develop a series of projects for an exhibition titled Outside Design, which was a collateral program of the Chicago Architecture Biennial this fall. And this is a photo from the exhibition's opening night. Now, one of the pieces that we developed for that exhibition was a modified version of the Habitat Wall project. So it, unlike that first wall that you saw, which was actually supposed to be about 20 feet tall and was supposed to be built outside, obviously, for the gallery, we ended up having to shorten the whole piece to 9.5 feet, so that's why it looks kind of all squashed right now and it's much shorter. But anyway, so, you know, obviously it's not going to work, it's not going to attract animals if it's inside a gallery, but I think the idea was to incorporate it as part of the show so that one could actually, so that, you know, visitors could take a look and say, oh, you know, this is what a wall could look like if we wanted to invite different species to live in a structure. So here's some photos from the construction process, and you can see some of the salvaged materials being worked into the layering system. Here's the thing almost done. This is the sort of backside of it, and you can see the kind of birdhouses and the kind of the structures for the cliff-dwelling birds are realized in the back. This is the front of the project. So again, these are the modules kind of sitting within these frames. And this was kind of interesting. So at the opening reception, we were really excited that the project provoked this kind of response. This guest here is obviously basically just trying to get a backside view of the structure. So she laid on the floor and looked up, you know, looked into the structure. It was amazing to me that, you know, that the project would invite, you know, someone to want to look at it from this kind of different perspective. And another funny thing was throughout the fall semester, the Chicago Gallery hosted a number of events like lectures and seminars, and they had hosted a number of high school students and middle school students to come through and look at the pieces, and they had these students, you know, as part of the process, design these inquiry questions or write out these inquiry questions, and I found it hilarious that one student decided to rename the Habitat Wall Cat Buffet. I'm not sure you can read that. So it's, I don't know, I was pretty excited about that. So we're interested in this idea of shifting human perspective through these kind of small-scale interventions, whether it's looking from an alternative point of view or simply triggering some sense of curiosity. This next project, Bat Cloud, follows along the same line of thinking. The idea here is to introduce a habitat intervention as an artifice in a setting where you might not necessarily expect to see it as such. So we conceived of this project as a cloud floating in the middle, you know, hanging, floating in the trees, something that you might just suddenly encounter while you're on a nature walk or on a trail or something like that. And the idea is that from afar it would appear like this big floating mass, but as you get closer, you can see that it's a series of pods, individual pods, that would house something. So there was a sign nearby so people could actually read about it, but we wanted to sort of provoke curiosity and sort of have people ask, well, what is this? Why is this thing hanging here? So to explain what these pods are, each pod is essentially a bat is constructed like this. So there's a kind of bat habitation area above and a kind of planting area below. Each pod, this is conceived of as a kind of self-sustaining ecosystem where maybe it's obviously not a full ecosystem, but it would be a self-sustaining project where if bats were inhabiting habitation areas above, that the guano would drip down and start fertilizing the plants below, so the guano would actually be useful to some degree. Let's see. Well, I mean, also, before I really talk about this, I guess what was interesting about this project also is that, like the Bat Tower, it was developed as a kind of sightless prototype. So we actually didn't really know where we were going to put this, and we just knew we wanted to hang it somewhere and have this thing kind of appear like a cloud. But fortunately, we were able to be commissioned through this organization at UB called the Humanities Institute. They formed a program called Fluid Culture where they connected us with the Tipp Nature Preserve in Buffalo, which then became a sort of partner and provided a site for the project. The Tipp Nature Preserve is an interesting site. It was a dump site for the city's garbage in the 50s and 60s, and in 1972 it was created as a preserve. Now it's managed by Buffalo Museum of Science, and so it's actually a capped landfill. So it's almost like coincidentally we were so fortunate because they didn't want any punctures in the ground anyway since it's a landfill, so we were like, oh, perfect, we're going to hang our thing in trees anyway, so that's what we're doing. So it actually all worked out. And here's a plan showing the project hanging in the trees. We were using the trees as a kind of series of anchors for a series of cables. We designed these vessels to essentially hang in clusters on these cables. And like the last projects, the fabrication of this took place in-house through relatively modest means. This is the construction of each pod, if anybody's curious. It's basically three pieces of folded stainless steel mesh that's folded for rigidity and bolted together. And the vessels were all prefabricated off-site and driven to Tift, along with a few ladders, a bunch of hand tools, very simple construction again. And thankfully, we had very nice weather that day and an amazing team, so they were able to put up the project in less than 12 hours. One of the issues, again, that we've been thinking about in this project is addressing heat retention and internal temperature. So what we've learned from the Bat Tower project and from previous research that bats need relatively stable and warm environments. And this is obviously one of the reasons why bats occupy interior spaces like attics, indoor spaces. But we realized after looking at the Bat Tower project that while that project was actually doing well in the summer, it wasn't really warm enough in the winter. So with this project, with Bat Cloud, we started looking at how to make insulated pods. We're working with insulation of different kinds, and you can see through this kind of that middle set of photos where you see me sitting with a jacket and my assistant with a sweater, that the pod basically functions kind of like a jacket. In that, I don't know if you can see it a little bit, in this right here, we basically heated up a kind of gel pack and shoved it in there just to see what would be the heat retention inside that pod, and you can see, you know, that it's holding in the heat much better the way that my winter jacket does, much better than the sweater that you see on the right. We were developing a second iteration of this project, so we were actually working through several versions of insulation, trying to figure out ways of retaining heat on the inside. So this is another kind of series of tests on this. We developed a second iteration of this project for the Rotterdam Architecture Biennial in 2014 at the Kunsthal in Rotterdam, Netherlands. So here's us hanging the project in the space. Here's it finished. And it's pretty exciting. They wouldn't let us put plants in here, so we had to put that hay in instead for this interior space. But after this exhibition was over, we actually worked with some local organizations and the city of Rotterdam to relocate the project to a public park in Rotterdam. And so here, this is its relocated location under, actually this is a crowd-funded bridge by Zeus. It's pretty interesting that there's this whole kind of like urban infrastructure in Rotterdam is all crowdfunded. And so this firm was actually interested in, you know, putting this project there. Now it's, from what I understand, although I haven't been keeping up with it, unfortunately, but it's being monitored by an ecologist. So Bat Cloud for me has provoked a number of reactions, and I think the perceptual effects of the project make it a sort of unexpected encounter, which has seemed to catch the attention of a lot of the local population in Buffalo and the media as well. And since the installation, I've been contacted by a range of people in Buffalo with questions like, how do I remove a bat from my house? To could I sell them a pod? Can I make one of these things for them? And I also received an email from a Boy Scout, or several Boy Scouts, saying that they wanted to build bat houses for the Eagle Scout project. So it's interesting just the kinds of emails I've been receiving since this project was installed. And so in the grand scheme of cities and regions, projects like Bat Tower, Habitat Wall, Bat Cloud are small, but I think they're able to instigate curiosity at a larger scale. And so I like to think about their potential not as isolated moments, but also as something that can be deployed within a larger urban system. Now in this this photo series of images here, in the bottom map you're looking at South Buffalo, and that little fuzzy green area at the bottom is the Tift Nature Preserve where Bat Cloud is located. And the black spaces are all these vacant lots in that area. At the top are some kind of abandoned kind of vacant structures that you might find along the Buffalo River, many of which are actually already being used by animals anyway. So I was interested in, you know, speculating, well, what if you start with this as a current condition today, you know, post-industrial city full of vacant land, what if you started with this, and you started to think about them, these spaces, not just as empty space and abandoned buildings, but also as potentially as productive landscapes that can provide habitat for wildlife and vegetation. So if the bigger goal is to create conditions for species to thrive in cities, then I think we have to think about these small-scale interventions not as end products in and of themselves, but also really more importantly as a way to instigate the beginning of a series or as a trajectory of interventions. So then my question then is, how do you produce an aggregation of effects within a larger territory? So thinking about this potential to produce larger social and ecological effects, we became interested in ways that we could look at urban regulatory structures, such as zoning, and look at possible ways to mine them. Now, this is a kind of a snapshot of a small portion of Buffalo's online learning map. Currently, some of you might know this, but Buffalo is undergoing a major zoning overhaul. Its zoning ordinance hasn't been changed since 1951, so it's quite outdated. It's now there's this new thing called the Buffalo Green Code that's going on. And this is a new framework that the city's adopting. The research that I'm about to explain has nothing to do with that, so I'm not actually participating in the city's development of the Buffalo Green Code. I actually ended up, prior to the Green Code work happening, I got a grant to look at Buffalo Zoning Code and to try to find interesting things about it. And at first, I was really just trying to visualize it, because as an architect, I look at the zoning code and my immediate reaction is that I want to diagram it, because it's all in text, right? So I wanted to find a way to make the zoning code more accessible. And as I was looking at it, I found ways to kind of mine it in what I think are hopefully productive ways. So again, the research I'm about to show you is really more about, you know, thinking about what you could do with the city's existing outdated code within this interim period of transition. So this is a redrawn map of Buffalo's zoning. And you can see that it's a city that's filled with a lot of parks, conservation areas, and recreation areas, which are all shown in shades of green. And aside from the Olmsted Parkway system, which you can faintly just barely see on this, in fact, you probably can't even see it, but there isn't really a system that allows one to weed habitat development throughout the city. And so the research project that we developed was titled Generative Zoning. We were looking to find opportunities within the system to combat habitat fragmentation and to promote a much more continuous system for animals in the city. Now, when we received the grant, as I mentioned, we first started off just trying to visualize the code. So we started off just thinking, okay, let's draw setbacks. Like, what does this look like? We wanted to comprehend all this kind of complex language. We were looking at the form-based codes first, but then we quickly started looking at the list of permitted uses in the code. And we started listing them and analyzing them through this diagram. This is hard to read, so I'll zoom in a bit. And you can see that what this is essentially a nested, and I guess most of you are probably planners, so I'm sure you know this type of thing better than I do, but it was amazing. What was interesting to me was that our city has a nested system where, you know, all the kind of uses that are allowed in R1, residential 1, are also the same uses that are allowed in R2, residential 2, which are also the uses allowed in R3, etc. So it's a kind of nested system. And we also started noticing as we were reading these things, so these kind of categories are categories that I came up with myself when I was reading all these uses, because the uses are just kind of listed there under different, under R1, R2, etc., but the uses are actually quite different in each category. And I started noticing patterns of conditions and started marking them in different colors. One particular condition that I thought was very interesting is that, so anything marked in green, and I'm sure you can't read it, but anything marked in green, light green or dark green there, is a condition that calls for setbacks of 50 to 100 feet minimum if a manufacturing zone abuts a residential zone. And I was thinking, wow, that's really big. You know, 100 foot setback is like half a block in Manhattan, New York. So we set out to look at some of these spaces in the city, and we found stuff like this. Like, if you have a huge setback, at least in places like Buffalo, you end up with just not a lot happening. They're seen as restrictions. Oftentimes, you see cars parking in them and trash, and these spaces are not used very well. So we decided to take a closer look. So I zoomed into one particular area again. Here I'm looking at, so all of those dotted green lines are the boundaries between residential and manufacturing zones. And then I zoomed into this area even, and clearly you can see which side of it is residential, which side is the manufacturing industrial zone. And I just quickly went through Google Street View just to look at what that looked like. And again, you can see this big setback on the left-hand side of the industrial, industrially zoned part of the city, while there's residential on the right. This is what it looks like walking down that street. So there's a very big setback, again, without a lot going on, very big setback. So looking back again now at the same map, so this is the same city map that I had redrawn, we highlighted all of the boundaries between manufacturing and residential districts, and we speculated, well, since these extra large setbacks of 50 to 100 feet are required in these conditions, could these not start to form a network of green spaces or some kind of green infrastructure? So what if we started to make these strands more continuous, if we started linking them through vacant parcels and other green spaces in the city? So what if we started getting conditions like this? Well, these are literally, all I'm literally doing is outlining boundaries and linking them through vacant parcels. You would end up with situations like this. Another condition that we noticed in this look, in this kind of exploration of the permitted uses of Buffalo, is that anything that's marked in blue, so the light blue or dark blue, indicates a type of program that requires a perimeter wall at least 6 feet high around the property, or requires that certain building faces are totally enclosed, with stationary windows only, or without any windows at all. And so these programs include things like manufacturing plants, storage facilities, pool halls, bowling alleys, small animal hospitals and kennels, and auto repair shops. And so in my mind, those are opportunities. Again, this is like one of these conditions where, you know, blank wall is required essentially by code. So these in my mind, I thought, were great opportunities to start to propose wall-based habitat infrastructure. So like, what if you, instead of having something on the left, you end up with something on the right where there's a, where you see a wall-based habitat project as a viable means for tackling what we think of now as typically restrictions by zoning ordinances. So I mentioned earlier that the implementation of small-scale work has piqued the interest of the community and the larger public, and definitely the idea of consciousness raising is important to me. And I've also been interested in how the production of material interventions can instigate action at many levels, such as forming productive collaborations and alliances, or engaging with interdisciplinary groups and other organizations, et cetera. And so as one example, I have been, throughout the process of my work, I've actually been forming a loose collaboration with a biologist at the University of Buffalo, Katarina Dittmar. She's a faculty member in the Department of Biological Sciences, and at first she began as a consultant for the Bat Tower Project, advised us on a bunch of issues, from site selection to thinking about spaces and textures of the tower. It's really interesting to go for a walk with biologists and ecologists. So as an architect, I'm walking around looking at space and material and light details and stuff, and here's them looking for animal feces. They're looking for animal droppings. So they get excited by this kind of thing. And here they're really excited because they're kind of decomposing deer on the site. From this relationship with Katarina and her colleagues, we've developed several initiatives. First, we're thinking about architectural products as part of ongoing science experiments. Katarina has, for example, taken one of the bat cloud pods to her research station in Puerto Rico to look at activity, to monitor changes in temperature, humidity, and obviously those are conditions that are important for habitats. Her, you know, doing this was also what prompted us to do these kind of makeshift science experiments with the, you know, and buying a thermal camera and doing these kind of, you know, amateur experiments in the architecture school. We've also, Katarina and I and her PhD student have talked about ways of engaging the urban landscape of Buffalo, specifically thinking about the habitat fragmentation issue that I was talking about before. And so along these lines, now this is a sort of separate project. We were talking about this, we're still kind of thinking about this, but along these lines, now for the outside design exhibition in Chicago, I developed a research project that I sort of worked with them on as well, to document and map urban species in the city. And this is completely focusing on species that inhabit building edges. So this is the, you know, the Art Institute of Chicago And there's, you know, there's one sock that is just constantly filled with pigeons, as you can see here. And so the question that I was kind of thinking about in this research project was, you know, how do you think about spaces in the cities and how animals occupy them when the spaces were not intended for them? So in this process, I went around Chicago, looked at different spaces where you could see animals, and having so there's actually a kind of whole crowd of pigeons living behind the Art Institute sign, and you can see evidence of that here. It's, I actually have videos of pigeons like coming out from that crack. It's pretty funny. But we started off basically just, you know, going around the city, looking, you know, different times of the day, looking for animals in different locations. And we developed a catalog of locations around the city. So in this case, I was working with local biologists in Chicago and the building maintenance and pest control staff at the School of the Art Institute. And we decided to focus on a number of locations. And in these locations, we placed camera traps. So I'm sure you guys probably know what they are, since many of you are in ecology. But there are cameras that are used primarily by biologists and hunters to document animals, and they're primarily motion triggered. So we were finding locations to put these camera traps. And it's funny, I'll show you just maybe one or two videos. Let's see if it works. Here's a break. And then this is a pretty particularly racy photo of some rats. That this camera caught. So I have so many of these videos. It's kind of unbelievable. I have so many rat and raccoon and squirrel videos. But these are two really funny ones. I thought. Okay, so that was fun. Another fun part of this research is, as it turns out, as I'm sure you suspect, security surveillance cameras are also motion triggered. And they're also located on building edges. So we made a whole argument to the building maintenance people and the security crew there, and we were actually given access to their security system. And so I was basically going through their security videos and looking, you know, for specific videos that would show, you know, high animal activity. It took a pretty long time to look at those videos. But we did find some that were pretty interesting. There's this really active crow population on the top of one of the roofs. So here's some like really funny. So this is all taken by the security surveillance camera at SAIC. And we've been, you know, taking a lot of these photos and mapping them back into the Google Map to sort of, you know, try to build up this base of information. Now, also at the level of architectural activism, I've been interested in the issue of bird glass collisions, which I'm sure you know a lot about. It's the number one killer of birds in urban environments, and as I'm sure you know, there are lots of organizations that are already working on this. In the States, there's the Audubon Society and the American Bird Conservancy that are writing bird safe building guidelines. We see the development of bird safe glass by Ornolux. And there's even a lead pilot credit that's developed by the USGBC that's geared toward bird collision benchmarks, which is this is what I want to show. So, they're using a lead pilot credit for bird collision deterrence. Now, so obviously there's people working on it, but what I've been interested in is what I see as a kind of conflicting set of interests. On the one hand, the desire to save birds from being killed by windows, and on the other hand, our extremely valuable desire for clear, frank views. So, you know, this need to have a, you know, clear window is an extremely valuable situation, right? So another piece that I developed for the Chicago exhibition is a temporary renovation of a window in a gallery space, and this is in the Carson Perry Scott Building, designed by Louis Sullivan in Chicago. This project is called No Crash Zone, and the idea here is that the design would play off of the existing ornament of the building, but it also makes visible the logics of bird strike prevention patterning. And at the same time, the idea was that it also plays into the humanist desire for the frame view. So in this case, it's invoking the idea of the single point perspective. So this is literally the drawing that I did that was put on the window. So you can see that there's the pattern around the edge that kind of looks like the you know, that invokes the single point perspective, but then there's also these other dots in the background that could potentially blend into the background, although it, they don't really do that in real life. You see them here. But here's a close-up of some of the pattern. Here's another close-up. This is what the thing looks like at night. So in the past few years also, I've been working to more intensely incorporate some of these agendas into my teaching, and you know, kind of positing to students to rethink the idea of the urban wilderness. And as an educator, I'd like to bring these kind of ideas into the teaching and research environment. So a few years ago, I taught a couple of studios where I asked students to research the role and place of urban species and consider ways of spatializing their presence. This is a project by Matt Ryberg, where he basically proposes to use discarded pallets of tennis balls to create habitats for mice to draw them away from nearby residential zones where they're not welcome. Because he found that mice like to live inside these cut-apart tennis balls since it's actually pretty insulated and warm. This is a proposal by a student named Tim Gargiulo that reconsiders the typology of the skyscraper to accommodate large birds of prey, such as falcons. And in this studio, Katarina Dittmar, the biologist, was also an instructor and advisor to the students. Now, in 2012, I co-organized a competition in Buffalo for students to propose a new bee habitat to move an existing hive in a window. So this is what we found in the window in a building that was slated for renovation. Together with two other faculty members, Martha Ball and Chris Romano, we developed a student competition called Hive City. And this brought in around 25 student competitors. And the idea was basically, you know, what can we do to relocate these bees from this building that's about to be renovated into a different place? The owner actually initially wanted to just bring in a regular beekeeper and have him take the bees away, but we're like, no, let's try something else. Let's try an experiment. So after series of rounds of competition, this is the winning project. This is called Elevator Bee. It was designed and built almost entirely by the student team with advisement from faculty, structural engineers, and beekeepers. The students, I'm going to read it at the bottom, but they are Courtney Creenan, Kyle Maselinski, Dan Mead, Scott Seelan, Lisa Stern. And the sponsor of this project was Rick Smith of Rigidized Metal, a metal manufacturing company in Buffalo, who is also the owner of this site. The site itself has become known as Silo City. It's it's a post-industrial piece of land, formerly with functioning grain silos. Now it's being repurposed as a site for different events and installations. And before, I was talking a bit about how public perception changes once you implement something. And so what's been interesting here in this project with Hive City is that I think it's also shifted some of the public opinion on the usefulness of constructing habitats. So before the students actually realized the project, built the project, there was an article that went out in the Buffalo News about the fact that we were doing this, that the faculty are organizing a competition for students to design a beehive, on post-industrial land. And the comments in the news before it was constructed were things like this. How in any way is a beehive on someone's private property in any way going to help downtown Buffalo or the waterfront? Sounds ridiculous. Why do we want more bees downtown? Drive the last three tourists out? Build something useful in the land that everyone can use. Or the waterfront ideas presented each week get increasingly worse. Next week we'll read that some other fringe group has decided to plant 14 acres of poison ivy on water and recycling wastewater from the city, all paid for by a grant from the U.S. Botanical Society with a new 14-member panel appointed by the governor to explore the best possible use for the waterfront that he will never visit. So these are the kind of comments that we're getting before the thing was actually built. And so after it was built, we were getting these kinds of write-ups, like from this is from Fast Company and from Wired. The shift in perception, the shift in attitude has actually been really interesting and revealing. And now the project is one of the most kind of popularly visited sites in Buffalo, apparently. And they've been staging all these different festivals around it, like Insectable, things like that. So we're really happy with that and with that, the way that turned out. So our aims in instigating action among students, architects, and the public are twofold. First, we're interested in exploring new models of practice. As you know, if you're familiar with architects, usually architects are paid to do a service. So somebody's commissioning you to do something, and you're kind of working a service to a client. So we're thinking about how can we rethink that as a model. In our work, it's been really difficult to find organizations outside of the university or arts grants that are interested enough to sponsor the work. And of course, you know, as you can imagine, saying that you're going to do architecture animals doesn't lend to any lucrative commissions immediately. So generally, even if parties or organizations are interested in what we're doing, such as like farming groups or bat conservation groups, they typically don't give us funding up front, and they're helpful in other ways, but it usually takes a while for them to kind of come around. And so usually in our process, the idea and some kind of idea and prototypical development will have a birth before the funding comes in. And as you can see, the support is typically from educational and arts institutions and grants. And so I think working in this way also addresses a bigger discussion about whether or how architecture can move beyond its status as a service industry and towards some kind of understanding of it as a tool for advocacy. And the second aim of instigating action among students, architects, and the public is that we're interested in impressing upon them that the consideration of urban animals should not be necessarily a niche interest in our field, in the field of architecture, since occupation by animals is in many ways a kind of default condition in cities, as you all know as well. So I'm interested in thinking about how, for the discipline of architecture, how these issues can directly impact the core of the discipline. So for example, if you think about the Pantheon, or you think about ornament, this is the Pantheon in Rome, it's possible that facade articulation, which we typically associate with proportioning systems and style, might start to take on more responsibilities. Maybe ornament, this is also a photo from Rome, maybe ornament will become more performative in supporting species. So perhaps instead of finding bird deterrent spikes on buildings, you might instead find cornices and other facade articulation that become enhanced and enlarged to welcome bird perching and nesting. And also, I'm interested in thinking about adaptive reuse. Could we think about a new range of strategies for using existing buildings and structures in cities? Right now, when we think about the term adaptive reuse, it actually has a very narrow definition. We think about it really only in one way, like reusing a building and making a condo and making it something else for humans. But since we know that many buildings already are a form of shelter for urban wildlife, how can we capitalize on what they're doing? I'd also like to think about how we can also reconsider the idea of urban maintenance. When we think of maintenance today, we think of lawn mowing, tree trimming, street cleaning, garbage disposal, and embedded further in maintenance routines are chemical processes like fumigation. But we tend to forget that animals themselves also perform a kind of ecosystem service for our cities. So for example, bats eating mosquitoes, spiders eating other insects, stray cats eating rats. So how can we consider the landscape as something that's more wild and varied, an environment that could be much more conducive to many different types of habitats? And in recognizing that animals serve as a significant form of urban maintenance, we're advocating for an architecture that embraces the potential that might come out of these relationships. So of course, you can think of the spider web as a nuisance on the one hand, you might also consider this condition in 2010 after a massive flood in Pakistan, when spiders ran up these trees after the flood and produced these huge tree webs, which I actually think are stunning. And they also, I guess, temporarily relieved the town of mosquitoes momentarily. So as architects, I think we first need to recognize the potential of unexpected situations in the ecological world and their consequences, but also think about them spatially and performatively. And while we often hear about the performative value of organisms, like oil-eating bacteria, we won't be able to take advantage of new opportunities that arise until we overcome our fear and loathing of pest species. So for example, scientists at North Carolina State University are experimenting with cockroaches, some of you probably know about this, outfitting them to find trapped earthquake victims. And so while this is seen as a major step forward in the world of search and rescue operations, it's still being met with comments such as, this is quoted directly from a comment section of the Huffington Post, "I'd rather die under a collapsed building than be approached by a roach." I don't know. So finally, we will reach a point when we as architects will need to grapple with the ethical dimensions of including and instrumentalizing animals as part of our ecosystem. And as animals begin to occupy a more visible place in the conception and construction of urban environments, we need to revisit this question of how we are defining the limits between our world and the world of the other. So as we begin scripting animals into our plans for buildings and cities, how will we now consider their value, not only in terms of performance and ethic and aesthetics, but also as sentient forms of life? And in the pursuit of cross-species design, we will ultimately need to grapple with more ethically difficult questions that challenge the way that we fundamentally think about our own values, not only in terms of design, but also in terms of life itself.
Because the decline has been like by over 95%, there's probably a lot of habitat out there because the bats have gone missing. Mm-hmm. And I was looking at the structures and thinking, man, those are really hard to clean. And bats don't need habitat, they need disease-free habitat. So when you're designing these things to help an animal in the face of a threat, are you thinking about how you can mitigate the threat as well?
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's true. I think those structures are really hard to clean. I think that when we were conceiving these structures, we were thinking of them as sort of temporary as well, like that they would be up. They could, house. I wasn't thinking that, for example, that one structure could save, a whole population in this area. And if I were to do that, I would be doing something like that one, that big cave, is it in Kentucky, I think, that they built a kind of underground cave? That thing is millions and millions of dollars. That is a much larger endeavor that has, there's ways to clean it. That's something that I would be very interested in doing. I don't have that funding at the moment. And so in terms of these small-scale works, I think the idea is first, can we make something that where people would actually say, hey, this is interesting. Why would anybody want to save bats? And then move on from there. So I think in the grand scheme of the ecology of that area, I'm sure that one tower made no difference at all whatsoever in terms of saving. I think if anything, there has been some bats that have been using it, but it's not it's become a major roost or anything like that or whatever. So, but yeah, I mean that's a good question.
And there's a lot of literature about bird feeders and hummingbird feeders and bird boxes that do show that over the landscape they do encourage the spread of diseases mm-hmm. amongst native animals. So just something to
yeah. That's a good suggestion.
I do apologize because I came late, so you may have covered this earlier, just let me know. I love how you're talking about both pollinators and habitat. But I was wondering if sort of plants you might be incorporating, the areas you're incorporating would be also incorporating food plant species, like native food plant species. Mm-hmm. So bushes that have berries for native species, native birds and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Because especially in urban landscape, not only do we put pesticides and fertilizers over everything, but it tends to just be one of three species of grass and trees mm-hmm. and nothing much else. Mm-hmm. So is that incorporated in some of the things that you've been working on?
Yeah, that's a really good idea. I haven't been incorporating the species that I'm incorporating are native species, but they're not, and I'm sure maybe deer would eat them, but I haven't been thinking specifically of certain berries or anything, thinking about them as food source, but I do try to use the native plant species in the projects that I have.
Thank you, Joyce. This was a very interesting talk, especially a person who's very new to this area. I was wondering if you can speak to your experience about working with the building maintenance and the pest control people at the Art Gallery in Buffalo, and if their perceptions have changed in terms of their work and their relations to, let's say, the pigeons.
You mean in Chicago or?
Was it in Chicago?
Yeah. When I did the habitat mapping or the animal documentation project in Chicago, I needed to work I needed to basically sort of consult with the building maintenance and pest control people there. They had a lot of knowledge of different locations where these animals were around and stuff. And I think, you know, I think they're sort of conflicted because the one guy who was the sort of head of pest control there seemed to really like the idea that rats were there, but his job was to get rid of them. So he was like, oh, you know, he kept calling them little critters, you know, things. I don't know. I think he actually really enjoyed the fact that I was interested in this, which was surprising to me because, you know, I was thinking, oh, this person is not gonna be interested. So he was actually really interested in the videos of the rats and stuff. But, yeah. I don't know, is there another
So I guess the final question is, in terms of your structures and let's say the wall structures that you propose, do you think people who work with maintaining these buildings would be interested, or you could convince them to, let's say, install these walls?
Mm. Well, that's actually something that I've been thinking about. So these walls that you're seeing here are all kind of prototypes, and many of them are meant to be sort of temporary, and you know they have a few years kind of lifespan. Although one of them is up now for 5 years and it seems to be doing fine. But in the kind of larger project that I'm designing, I've been thinking about things like, is it possible to, you know, to always have sloped surfaces so you can always get water, for example, to wash certain surfaces? Because there's, when you have a lot of these crevices and stuff, obviously, it's really, unless you're able to kind of, you know, to really kind of put water in different places, it's not like you can go in there with your hand and clean it or something. So, so that's something I have been thinking about with the larger designs.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. I mean, there were so many great ideas and so much to think about. And I was thinking about the ethical shifts, you know, with these aesthetic changes and with the ethics changing and shifting and how thoughts, actions also change. So even thinking about what's endangered and what can be saved, I think it has so much to do with managing the people, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm not a planner, but I was very curious. This catalog of locations sounds wonderful, especially with the edges and corners in cities. And the other thing was the zoning codes. I thought the setback piece was fascinating, because you think of all the land in Toronto with setbacks. Do you have any more examples of that?
just like looking in Buffalo. I mean, in Toronto, do you all have really big setbacks like we do? I mean,
those pictures really look familiar. like they could have been here.
Because I just can't imagine, like, you know, for example, New York City, I can't imagine that there is really anywhere with a 100-foot setback with such valuable land there. So, I don't know, but in Buffalo, I think a lot of it is also that our code is outdated. And there are codes there are setbacks for very, very strange reasons too. Like there are things like 50-foot setbacks around mental hospitals, you know, things like that. You know, so there's a lot of kind of very, very, you know, outdated codes right now. And then there's that whole thing about the zoning between residential and manufacturing. But I don't know if there are other cities that have this as, you know, have such a large setback condition.
I wanted to tag on because I was curious about that too, with what strategy might you employ if you're looking at very good cities? Because obviously you have this spatial eye that sees something that is intended for one thing, and you go, oh, it's an
opportunity. That's really interesting. Maybe it has something to do with the vertical setbacks, or maybe there's instead of when you think about setbacks for high buildings, you start thinking about those terracing, those gardens or something. But I think that's definitely something I'd like to do, is look at a different type of city. I think the post-industrial declining city is definitely one model. But
I'm sure you can help me.
Justin. Kind of a big question. I was interested in ecological restoration. We talk a bit about how there's a lot of choices involved about what you're restoring to and choosing what species or assemblages. Mm-hmm. And so if we're designing for wildlife, I was wondering if you had thought about that, like which wildlife will we design for and how do we make those kinds of decisions?
Yeah, that's a really good big question.
Maybe we can talk about it over the weekend.
No, I would love to. I'm really excited to be here because I know that you guys are all specialists in this more so than I am. I'm literally trained. trained as an architect. I'm not trained as an ecologist. And so I think a lot of my research in this has really been speaking with biologists, but also just looking at things like sprinkle that animal diagram that I have where there's like a lot of like lines crossing back and forth. That's the kind of thing that I think about a lot when I'm trying to make decisions, and I'll have the, you know, names of things with lines and circles, and then at some point I'll just be like, I just want to do something, you know, I just want to work on something, and then, I focus on the bat because it was, I was actually kind of interested in the myth and the kind of bad rap that they get, and actually when I first moved to Buffalo, I was just kind of shocked because somebody was telling me that, oh, you know, there's a lot of bats around here, and you can kill them if you swing a tennis racket. And so I was sitting there thinking, like, what in the world? Like, why would anybody do that? You know, and so I was just thinking, if people would just stop swinging tennis rackets at bats, that would be a great start, you know? I don't know. So, yeah, but that's a really good question.
Yeah. Thanks, Joyce. That was a fantastic talk. There's a famous essay by the philosopher Thomas Nagel called Thinking Like a Bat, and Nagel arrives at the conclusion that you can't really do such a thing. And yet it strikes me that you are doing exactly that. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about the method whereby you would arrive at a kind of Bat's take on the city. It's almost like you've got a kind of Bat's geography of the city that you're coming to understand. Is that through the collaborations with the scientists, or is it through your own architectural training to kind of think about space?
Yeah, that's a really good question too. I feel like for me, moving to Buffalo has been quite instrumental in allowing me to kind of attempt to inhabit the space of animals. And again, I think one of the reasons for this is because it is a kind of declining post-industrial city with a lot of open spaces and all this overgrowth. And I'm actually a runner, so I run a lot. And when I'm running, I'll just kind of see all these things, and oftentimes I'll be in this kind of half zoned out situation, just really being much more observant than I normally would be if I'm running around checking my phone, for example. So I think being in that type of environment has actually enabled me to somehow, I don't want to say that I empathize completely, but there is a kind of a bit of empathy that I've been trying to kind of hone and develop a bit with some species. And I think talking about this with the biologists also helped, but with them I feel like they're much more knowledgeable about these things. So I actually feel like I'm receiving information rather than experiencing empathy. I don't know if that makes any sense at all. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean.
No, I think that's really helpful. So it's almost like kind of embodied practice.
Yeah.
And the running, I guess you're probably more of a, whether you're a prey or a predator species, but that process of moving through the city kind of creates a very different feeling for the place.
Yeah.
Looking at pictures of these books.
Yeah. I think when in a city, in certain types of cities, like unlike New York or other cities I've been to before, Buffalo is very quiet, so your level of observation goes up quite a bit, I think.